So, that being said, we can go back to the Newsham concept and ultimately our James Smith. And there were other American builders that picked up Newsham's ideas and used them to their own advantage. So, although I can't show you those engines here, I want to show you a pair of cylinders. So we have two cylinders. Inside each of those cylinders is a piston, which is connected to the rods coming out of the top. And those rods are connected to a mechanism on the bars or the brakes so that the pistons can then be driven down. And as the pistons are driven down, they're forcing the water into the air chamber and then up into the discharge nozzle. So, the water is now flooding in the tank here. So when the piston goes up, the water is being drawn into the piston, a valve closes, and the water is pushed into that discharge side. These early engines were not able to draft water from a pond. They had to be filled by buckets or some outside source. So, generally speaking, we believe that the suction engine was developed in the 1820s, and I'm going to show you some pictures of those a little bit later on, and actually the machines that have the pumps from that later period. So here is another diagram. This one has the valve chamber removed, so you can see the two valves. The two pinkish discs are the valves, and when the piston went down, the water in the lower chamber was pushed into the upper chamber, and that valve, which was hinged right there, would then lift and the water would come through. Then it would go down and lift and so forth, depending on if the piston was coming down. Here is another illustration. Different engine. This is a Newsham, or Newsham and Rag, from Colonial Williamsburg. And you can see the two discs, they're not attached here. This is part of the restoration photos. But these discs would be mounted on animal skin, and they would be hinged on the flat sides here and here. So this one would be lifting like that. And very crude and very simple. So in order for an engine to be able to lift the water and discharge the water, we have to have two layers of valves. And I guess I should have shown this to you as we were moving along, but this is another illustration of a Newsham. The one in Colonial Williamsburg is probably a Newsham and Rag. This is a Newsham. You can see a little bit different design here, but this is all hand-forged iron, and you can see the top of the piston. The piston would be made of bronze or iron, and then there would be a leather cup that would seal the sides of the piston to the cylinder walls. All right, let's see what else we've got here in terms of photographs. Okay, that's it on the piston pumps. All right, so if we turn our attention over here to this 1880s Glesson and Bailey, you can see the tops of the pistons. Let me get out of your way. You can see the tops of the pistons and the stuffing glands. This is a very small village engine, and this would be operated from maybe six men. So you'd have three per side or four per side.
And what year is this?
This is about 1880, and this engine can draft water with a suction sleeve coming in from the bottom. So you can't see very well because it's so dark in there, but you have the same type of clapper valves that I've already shown you in those pictures. And if you didn't have a hose to draft the water from a pond, then you could change the valve that's underneath and then fill the tank with buckets. And then the water will be pulled down into the pump from the tub where the water was being reserved, or the reservoir.
And what kind of wood is...
I am not sure, but if I had to guess, I would say that it's pine.
Okay. Very interesting.
This is a very simple engine, and it was not made with any kind of special consideration for decoration or for cabinetry. The pump itself was made by Glesson and Bailey, or for Glesson and Bailey, by Rumsey. The anchor, I believe, was their symbol because they had started their career making pumps for ships. They were very good bilge pumps, and so then they found the application for the bilge pumps, converted that to firefighting on land. Of course, the Baltimore got its start in firefighting in 1763 by the local men forming a fire company called the Mechanical Fire Company, and they bought a pump not dissimilar from this from a Dutch sailing captain. So the captain also used the pump to wet his sails to try to close the cotton fibers if they were trying to pick up a very light wind. But it could be used for firefighting, could be used for bilge pumping. So these pumps are multi-purpose, shall we say. And if they're portable, then they're even more useful. The fire department would take one of these pumps on a stand and mount it on wheels, and that's where your first fire engine came from.
Was Rumsey, is that James Rumsey? The Rumsey pump?
Oh, I don't remember his first name.
Mm-hmm. Just curious.
Okay, so we're going to go back a few years in time and look at this engine. This is an 1853 Smith. And so it's made by the same man that made the Smith that we looked at earlier. But this one is an extra large engine. I think this would be called a Class A engine. And I'm going to show you a photograph of its piston. This is the same basic clapper valve, but it has two sets of clapper valves. And one set is inside the piston, and it's now made of brass, and it has a leather hinge. So it's hinged on one side, just like the other valve, but it's a much larger valve, and it's rectangular in cross section.
And it's red brass, so it's really, it's impressive.
Okay. One of the things that intrigues me is that on this side of the piston, the bottom has been rounded to minimize the turbulence of the water. So now that we have a piston, that the piston itself is brass, the cylinder is brass, the piston has a leather cup, we have brass valves at the bottom with leather hinges, although I will admit that we have converted that leather hinge to a neoprene hinge, so we don't have to worry about the leather breaking, because we do operate this judiciously from time to time, it shows. So we have a pump which can draft water through the large suction sleeves, and we are no longer able to fill this with buckets. So by the time of the 1850s, you could choose between having an engine which would draft water or which could not draft water. And we have examples of both here. So you could have an engine which would be effective only in relay pumping or from pumping from a hydrant.
So this